Well, to tell us more about that meeting and to discuss the situation in Gaza and indeed Israel, our foreign affairs analyst Marco Vincenzino joins me now in the studio. Welcome, Marco. Now, tell us more about this cabinet meeting that took place today.
Yeah. Generally, there's words, particularly from the Interior Minister, Silvan Shalom, Interior Minister of Israel, making reference to the fact that individuals, because many of these acts are from lone wolf acts, okay, individual Palestinians stabbing Israeli citizens, and many of them obviously being either they have residence passes to live in Jerusalem or actually, yeah, Israeli citizens. He was making a lot of reference to the possible decision that he may take is actually strip these individuals of their citizenship, remove their residency, and then from there just remove them from the state of Israel. Maybe they'll go to the West Bank or elsewhere. But that's a threat, a clear threat that he mentioned today after the meeting.
Okay.
The time has come that those terrorists will be punished. And now I'm considering to take their citizenship and the residency, those that live in East Jerusalem. The time has come that they will realize that they cannot carry out such kind of terrorist attacks against innocent Israeli civilians and still remain citizens of the State of Israel or even residents of the State of Israel, that those lives in East Jerusalem with all the benefits that are coming with those with the citizenship and with the residency.
Marco, now these protests just seem to be spreading, don't they? I mean, the students clashing with the Israeli troops, is there any end in sight? Is this just going to continue?
There's a fear of a third intifada, a third general uprising, the first one having been in the 1980s, the right, second being from 2000, the year 2000 to 2005. And the difference between this is that in the past, if there have been conflicts, there may have been direct conflicts between forces of Hamas with the State of Israel. This one seems to be not controllable in the sense, mm-hmm, that it's all scattered. You have it within Israel proper, within Jerusalem, within the occupied territories. So there's a sense that they can be overwhelmed by a third uprising. And that's the fear, not just of Israel, but many other countries on both sides and within the region, and particularly from U.S. United States foreign policy perspective. From the United States foreign policy perspective is that there's enough problems in the region. The last thing they would want to see is a third intifada.
Absolutely. And tell us more about this holy site, which seems to also be sort of integral to this row.
Yeah, basically, it's what the Jews call the Temple Mount, and the Muslims call, Palestinians and Muslims, they call Al-Aqsa. For the Muslims, the third holiest site in Islam. Mm-hmm. For the Jews, it's the site where the original biblical temples stood. So in this sense, there's, you know, obviously people take their religion very seriously. Traditionally, the status quo on Al-Aqsa Mosque right now is the fact that Jews are allowed to visit, but only Muslims can pray there. Mm-hmm. And this last round of violence that sparked was because in recent months, there's been an increase in visits by Jews, and the Muslims fear that that's going to deny them greater access, and this is going to be a change in the status quo. The Netanyahu government said it's not going to be, mm-hmm, but the increased visits has been a sign of concern for many of the Muslims, and many Muslims, the young ones, were actually controlled, denied admission, yeah, based upon the recent round. The recent violence we've seen in the last 12 days, we've seen generally about 23 Palestinians dead and about 4 Israeli citizens. Okay. And once again, there is that fear that things can spin out of control into a third intifada.
And President Netanyahu's tried to impose some sort of restrictions on those visiting this site as well. So, I mean, what sort of benefit is that?
It's for the fact that there's the violence factor. Mm-hmm. It's the fear that if particularly young Palestinians, young Muslims visiting there will create problems.
Okay.
And that's where there's a fear that if the violence actually happens at Al-Aqsa Mosque itself, that could lead to the third intifada. In fact, the second intifada in the year 2000 was sparked by then when it was Ariel Sharon visited Al-Aqsa Mosque, mm-hmm, and then that was officially the beginning of the second intifada. So basically they're trying to prevent things from getting out of control on that specific holy site.
Okay. I mean, what level of intervention is needed, you know, from the wider world, external sources, U.S. perhaps?
This is difficult because in the past, when, for example, if you look in recent years, you had generally 3 conflicts, mm-hmm, in the Gaza Strip between the forces of Hamas and the Israeli Defense Forces. So once there's a direct conflict, both sides are controlled by a leadership. Mm-hmm. And so whenever even those were very brief conflicts, but very bloody ones. Mm-hmm. By then Egypt, Gulf states, the United States, they would play a key role, a diplomatic role, putting pressure on both sides to de-escalate. But when you have individual acts, lone wolf acts, a sense of a general popular uprising, it's very difficult for external forces to try to have leverage and to bear, because the leaderships themselves are not really able to control what's going on the ground.
Right. And obviously there's been more, I mean, the problem seems to be escalating with more airstrikes overnight as well, so...
Netanyahu used the word, say, there is no quick fix.
Right.
Because of that sense that you cannot actually control what's going on. There's not that sense of order that you can control. And so, and that's, I think he's already preparing, he's preparing the Israelis that this is going to last for a while. And there's no, I would say there's no end in sight, but right now it seems like things will escalate far more before they de-escalate.
Marking.